And triply, a hundredfold, Lord, reach down and bless each and every soul tonight, each and every life. Lord, do a work in our lives that we can be your people and do what you'd have us to do. Lord, help us to give of ourselves, of our time, Lord, that we can praise you and honor you. Help us to give of our worship, that we can give you our the glory, so that rocks don't cry out for us, but we cry out and we praise your holy name. We thank you, Lord, for all that you do and all that you've done. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. Worship the Lord God, this is the reason. Come sing a special. Hallelujah. 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 God is so good. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, God is so good. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
You know, I was going to ask y'all tonight if anybody in here had any troubles and trials. I do believe after the sermon this morning, I think it was already answered. I think we're all going through a bunch of those right now. And talking about nearing the end of this year, I think we'll all be glad to see the end of this year coming and a new one on the horizon. Praise the Lord that God will send blessings and peace down. Well, if you are in a trial or a situation right now, which I think we all are, and the best answer that I can give to you for those trials and tribulations is don't give up.
Amen.
Don't quit.
Amen.
Because Jesus will provide the answer. He's always
Amen.
There.
Yes.
That's
yes.
what this song's all about.
Yes.
I hope it'll bless you, and I hope you'll listen to the words.
Yes.
And you're feeling weak.
Oh, yeah. That's a lot.
And you're holding on with your last ounce of strength.
That's a lot. Yes.
Well, don't give up.
That's right.
And don't give. God's word.
Yes.
And just stand. Just stand. When you're done all you know to do, just stand. And he'll stand there by you. Just be still and see the hand of God move. Just stand and he'll stand. And we've all had fears. And we've all had moments that we held back the tears. But there's something special in those darkest hours. In your weakness, that you'll find God's power. So you'll just stand when you've done all you know to do. And he'll stand there by you.
Good to have people in the church that have different hobbies and different things that they can do, because if you wait on me to build something, you'll be waiting the rest of your life. But I'm not a carpenter. I can't build. If I tried to, as I said the other week, if I tried to build a birdhouse, it would be flat to where it should be, right? If I could get a gourd and put a hole in it, but other than that, I can't build it as far as the physical things. But God is so good, and he just blesses us, helps us out. 2 Samuel chapter 7. And it came to pass when the king sat in his house, and the Lord had given him rest round about from all his enemies, that the king said unto Nathan the prophet, see, now I dwell in the house of cedar, but the ark of God dwelleth within curtains. Nathan said to the king, go, do all that is in thine heart, for the Lord is with thee. Oh, I love that. The Lord is with thee. And it came to pass that night that the word of the Lord came unto Nathan, saying, go and tell my servant David, thus saith the Lord, shalt thou build me a house for me to dwell in, whereas I have not dwelt in any house since the time that I brought up the children of Israel out of Egypt, even to this day, but have walked in a tent and in a tabernacle. In all the places wherein I have walked with all the children of Israel, spake I a word with any of the tribes of Israel whom I commanded to feed my people Israel, saying, why build ye not me a house of cedar? Now therefore, so shalt thou say unto my servant David, thus saith the Lord of hosts, I took thee from the sheepcote, from following the sheep, to be ruler over my people over Israel. I was with thee whithersoever thou wentest, and have cut off all thine enemies out of thy sight, have made thee a great name, like unto the name of the great men that are in the earth. Moreover, I will appoint a place for my people Israel, and will plant thee, and they may dwell in a place of their own, and move no more. Neither shall the children of wickedness afflict them anymore, as before time, and as since the time that I commanded judges to be over my people Israel, and have caused thee to rest from all thine enemies. Also the Lord telleth thee that he will make thee an house. Heavenly Father, come before you tonight, love and praise you. I thank you for an opportunity tonight, Lord, that you've given me. Stand behind this sacred desk. Lord, I ask you, Lord, to measure to measure one more time. God, pour out of heaven upon this place, Lord, that we can be stirred up and we can understand what you have for us. God, anoint each and every word that comes out, Lord, that anoint every ear that hears, anoint every heart that receives, that we can be your people. God, we love you, we praise you, we thank you tonight for all that you do. In Jesus' wonderful, holy name we pray. The church said,
amen.
Amen. A house for God. A house for God. You see, this is after David had gotten the ark back. The ark of the covenant is brought back to Jerusalem from where it was in captivity. It was brought back to Jerusalem. This is after that God had blessed David, and he had blessed God. God had blessed him, and David was on his throne. King David was the king. King David was the one. He was in charge. He was on his throne, and he was in a place. He was in a house. He was in a physical house. He was there, and all that he had been giving, everything was going well for David at this time. Everything was going good for him. David was had accomplished a lot of things. His enemies were basically under his feet. His enemies were done. You see, all his enemies had quit fighting with him. He had rest. He was resting, and everything was going well. Everything was going great, and everything was going good for him. And as we look at this, and we understand, and we see the attitude that David had. He had an attitude. He said, I want to do more for my God. I want to do more. And he began to talk to Nathan the prophet. He began to talk to him and said, you know, I want to do something for God. I want to be somebody, do something for God, for God's word, for what he desires. And you know what? As we look at a time and look at a culture, we need to get back to the mindset to where we want to do more for God. God's done so much for you and I. He gives us life. He gives us breath. He gives us salvation. He gives us sanctification. He gives us the Holy Ghost. He gives us eternal life. He blesses us. He ministers. He heals us, and he blesses us. He touches us. He does miracles in our lives. And so many times we find ourselves taking God for granted when we shouldn't take God for granted, but we should strive to want to do more for our God, for our Lord and Savior. We should want to do more for God and to be a blessing to him and to be a blessing and be what he would desire us to be. But we should desire to be a house for God. Now, we're going to talk about physical houses. We're going to talk about spiritual houses. We're going to talk about all kinds of houses here in just a moment. But I want you to understand, we've got to look at what God did for David and what David did for God, how things worked out. First of all, I want you to understand, God called him. God called David. Nathan said, talk to the Lord about David. And Nathan talked to God, spoke to Nathan, said, I want you I want you to go and you find him and you tell him I'm sending you. God was sending Nathan to David and said, you know what? Now, David, you know, this is from the Lord. This is what the Lord wants you to remember. He wants you to remember that God was there when you were called to begin with. When you were anointed to be king, when you were anointed to be the next one, you were the one that was the chosen. You were the one that was blessed. God was there. God was with you. Now, when you were there attending to the sheep and taking care of the sheep, it was God that was with you. It was God that was there that whole time. When you were there, a shepherd boy taking care of the sheep, God had a calling on your life. God had a calling for you to be that house, hallelujah, of worship, that house of prayer, that house that you were supposed to be, that house that God could count on. God had sent word back to David, said, you know what, you've got to understand. He said, I took thee from the sheep coat, from following the sheep, to be ruler of my people over Israel. You know, it was a great task, and it was a great opportunity and a great job. It was a stressful job to be the king over Israel. It was a stressful job to be their king and to lead them, because there was a lot of people that didn't like everything that was going on, if you know what I mean. They didn't like everything that happened. Kind of like today. You know, we live in a time that we have to trust God. We have to believe God and understand God's got something more than he calls us out. Hallelujah. Every one of you have been called. Now, not everybody's been called to pastor or to preach or to be an evangelist, but everybody, as far as the preach behind the pulpit, but everybody's been called to preach the word, called to tell someone. You've been called out. There's a song that said, I've been called out for a purpose, called out. Hallelujah. To be a servant, called out. Hallelujah. I don't remember the rest, so I can't sing it to you. Praise the Lord. I know you're saying thank you, Lord. Don't sing it, preacher. Don't say hallelujah. Hallelujah. But God called me. God called him when he was over there as a shepherd boy, tending to the sheep. God called him to be that one that would lead Israel, that would be the king and would be in control. And he sent Nathan to him and said, hey, tell him this. He said, to tell him I was with him wherever he went, no matter where he was at, no matter what he was doing, I was there. No matter what was taking place in his life, I was there. No matter how bad he got, I was there. No matter how good he got, I was there. No matter when he was down in the dumps, I was there. No matter who was coming against him, I was there. God said, I'm in. Wherever he went to, wherever he was at in his life, I was there. Yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I was there the whole time. You see, God called him to a work. God called him to this. So yes, he called him to be a physical king. But God understood the mindset of David, the mindset and the heart set of David. God understood he could use this one because he was willing to listen and willing to heed God. And understand God. God said, I was with you. Oh, hallelujah. I love that. Whithersoever thou wilt. And have cut off all thine enemies out of thy sight. Have made thee a great name unto the name of the great men that are in the earth. He said, I was there with no matter what was going on. I've cut off the enemies. There was no enemy that could overcome you because I was with you, is what God was saying. David, if you overcome and you become a big name, because everybody knows the name King David. He said, it's because I was there with you. Hallelujah. And throughout time, throughout thousands of years, his name is well known. King David, hallelujah. He's well known across the land because everybody knows the scriptures and the stories. Might not know all the scripture, might not know everything exactly about it, but we all remember, you know, many times, you know, the enemy, he'll try to get us to focus on the negative part about David. The enemy will try to get us to focus on, well, he sinned against God, he Bathsheba. Yes, he did. But thank God, he repented and got things back right. Hallelujah. Many times we think about the story that we learned as a child about how he defeated Goliath, hallelujah, with a stone and a sling. Hallelujah. Remember that? God was there with him at that time too, wasn't he? Hallelujah. King David was blessed by God, was ministered by God. God had called him out of everywhere he was at, had called him in the direction he went, because, you see, David wouldn't have been out there with that giant had God not led the way. David would have not been king had God not led the way. David would have not been able to overcome all those enemies had God not led the way. Hallelujah. I'm talking about a good God that we serve. I'm talking about a good God. Let me tell you tonight, hallelujah, God's called you out of the miry clay, which he has in his word. He calls people like us to be separate. Come out from among me. Heard somebody say that this morning. Hallelujah. We're sitting in kings. Come out from among them, be ye separate. That's what he's called us out. You know why? because he wants to bless. He wants to go wherever we're at. Listen, God can go wherever we're at when we're his people. Hallelujah. But you know what? If we decide to do things that's not right and not according to his word, he's not going to stand there and watch us, because he has to turn his head to sin. He has to turn his head to the things that are wrong in this world. He has to turn his head to those things, because those things separate man from God. But David had that relationship. He had that right relationship. Hallelujah. God was calling. Hallelujah. He saved him out of those things, of those problems, and called him. You know what? He's calling us. He's saved us for a reason. And he's called you and I for a reason. And it's to lead others, to help others. You know what? We might not have a place called Israel that we're leading technically, but we've got an Israel that we are leading. I'm talking about people that you're around every day, whether it be family, whether it be on the job, whether it be wherever you go. You've got people you're supposed to be leading, and I'm supposed to be leading. We have people that we've got to reach out to. God's called us for a purpose, and we've got to get back to that business. We've got to get back to an understanding. God is the one that calls us to do that work. Called us to show the gospel. Called us to bring the good news. The good news. I said the other day, I was talking about the news. If you turn on the TV or the radio and you turn on the news, you're going to see a lot of negative stuff.
That's
right. A lot of bad things happen. A lot of things take place. A lot of disasters. But hallelujah. And we've got to be cautious about many things. I understand that. But hallelujah, let me tell you, we've got the good news to share. We've got the good news we can share with mankind. The good news. Say, preacher, what's the good news? The good news is Jesus still saves today.
Yes.
Hallelujah. He still cleanses hearts today. The good news is Jesus saves to the uttermost. Hallelujah. And people can have life eternal. Hallelujah. Everlasting life. John 3:16, everybody knows this. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Hallelujah. God still does that today. Yes, he does. In 2020, God still saves to the uttermost. God still reaches down and touches lives. Hallelujah. And he's called people. He's drawn people out of that deep miry clay for a purpose and a plan. And that's to understand that God is there with us, whithersoever we go. No matter what you're going through tonight, hallelujah. That song just went right with this message. God knows how to just make it all line up. Hallelujah. No matter what you're going through tonight, God is right here beside of you. And all you got to do is stand like the sun. Hallelujah. All you got to do is stand. Don't give up. Don't give in. The devil wants us to give in. He wants us to throw in the towel. He wants us to throw in the towel. I give up. God, I tried to serve you. I tried to do this and that. I just give up. There was a couple in the Bible like that, wasn't there? Yeah, Elijah did that, didn't he? Elijah, one of the two did that in the mountain. But the enemy wants to give up and say, well, I just things ain't going right. Well, guess what? When we look at things not going right, it's with physical eyes. But let me tell you, in those troubles and trials that we go through, it might be just everything lining up for what God's got in store for tomorrow.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Oh, yes, we don't like, none of us like pain, and I'm the worst. Hallelujah. If I get hurt, I'm hurt more than anybody in the world. If I'm sick, I'm sicker than anybody else in the world. That's just the way I am. I'm a pitiful sick person or injured person. and shots, I don't like shots. Because I'm just a baby when it comes to that. Those things. So no matter where we're at, no matter what we're going through, we'll stand. Those things that God's trying to bring us out of, those things we're trying to, even having to go through those shots or through sickness or through pain or through this, you know, God is growing us. And we'll keep the faith and we'll stand and we'll do those things and we'll let God work in our lives. God's called us for a purpose. God didn't call you. God didn't save you and save me to just do nothing. God saved us to be a people of praise, a people of worship, a people that love him and honor him and glorify him, a people that will share his gospel, the good news, to those around. That's what he called us out for. That's what he brought us up for. Hallelujah. He didn't bring us up so we'd be called a Christian and look perfect. He called us to be a Christian so we can help somebody else be a Christian. Hallelujah. To show the gospel, to show the good news. Talk about it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So God calls. Hallelujah. Secondly, this goes right along with it. God was with me. I like this again. We're going back to that verse. I got to get into double time tonight. And I was with thee whithersoever thou wentest. Verse 9 of chapter 7 of 2 Samuel. God was with me whithersoever thou wentest. No matter what he went through, no matter what he faced, God was still there. God was with him the whole time. God had called him for a purpose, not to leave him stranded, not to leave him out there on his own, not to leave him by the wayside, but God had called him so he could be with him and so he could help him. And God was with him through those times, through those things, no matter what was around, no matter what was happening, no matter the battles, no matter the quiet time, no matter the hard time, no matter the fires, no matter the enemy, no matter the fiery burst, no matter what it was, God was with him. God was there that whole time. And we know other stories in the Bible where God was with them, hallelujah, wherever they went. You know, Daniel, we understand the story about Daniel. Daniel, there was a decree. They said that. They said nobody's going to pray to their God for 30 days. Nobody's going to pray. Daniel, when he knew the decree, not before, when he knew the decree was signed, he goes and opens his windows just like beforehand. He said, I'm going to pray. Yeah. And he begins to pray just like he'd been doing. Hallelujah. And began to talk to God. And people saw the naysayers saw it and they went and told on him. And so because of the decree, he had to be thrown in the den of lions. But let me tell you, hallelujah, there wasn't enough lions in that country. And there wasn't enough hunger in those lions for that country. And there wasn't enough smelling good for Daniel for him lions to eat. Because God was there the whole time. God was already there when Daniel was praying. God was already there when Daniel was going, hallelujah, to his knees to lift up his head and magnify God. Hallelujah. God was there. When old King says, all right, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, I'll give you another chance. All you got to do when you hear all this is just bow down. They said, oh, we're not bowing down. You do what you got to do. We're not bowing down because they knew God was with them. Hallelujah. Three Hebrew boys were thrown in the fire. But hallelujah, when they got in the fire, they found there was a fourth. Yes. Like the Son of God. Hallelujah. Open in the fire with them. Hallelujah. You know what? God was with them whithersoever they went. Hallelujah. God was right there. Hallelujah. And the king lived in with verse 3. Oh, there's a fourth one in there. And you know what? There's a decree made upon the land to let people know that the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego was God, and nobody better ever talk ugly about their God again. You let me tell you, I'm telling you, God is there whithersoever you go. Don't worry about a thing. If God's called you out and God's saved you and God's blessed you, God's touched you, and God's moved in your life, don't you worry about a thing. Just let God do the work in your life. Hallelujah. 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 Prophets of Baal were on the mountain making a mockery of God and Elijah. Making a mockery. All right, well, Elijah said, well, let's just settle this today. What we're going to do is we're just going to have a showdown. It's layman's terms. We'll have a showdown. And who's ever God answers by fire, that's who God is with. Elijah knew his God. These other people, they didn't know what they was doing because it was all just phony baloney. So they built the altar. Laid the sacrifice there and built the trench and poured all the water on there. And those prophets of Baal, they began to pray. All they prayed. And they got crazy. They started cutting themselves and doing all kinds of ungodly stuff, thinking their God was going to answer. Well, you know what? Their God was not a God. And their God was dead. Their God was not real. Hallelujah. But Elijah gets up there and says, you know what? I'm going to pray just a little bit. And he prayed just a few words, hallelujah, and God answered by fire, and he licked up the sacrifice, he licked up the altar, he licked up the stones, he licked up the dirt, and he licked up the water. Let me tell you, God was there whithersoever he went, hallelujah. God was there no matter what Elijah was going through, no matter who was making a mockery of him. God was there, hallelujah, during that whole time. Let me tell you, God is so good. God is moving in ministry. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, this is one I love to talk about. Samson. Samson, yes, he did wrong, and he went against God and told how he had the strength. But let me tell you, in the end, he said, oh, God, if you just one more time give me the strength, one more time give me the opportunity, one more time, let me be avenged of this that they've done. They plucked my eyes out, and they're making me a mockery for you, God. And God, one more time, gave him strength. Gave Samson strength. He was able to tear the house down. And when he tore the house down, hallelujah, he killed more in that time of the enemy than he had beforehand. Let me tell you, God was there whithersoever he went. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, you want to hear some more? I got some more for you. Hallelujah. How much time you got tonight? Praise God. Hallelujah. Paul and Silas was in jail at the midnight hour. Hallelujah. Paul and Silas, all they'd done was what all they knew to do, and that was talk about the Lord. Hallelujah. You know what? That's about all I know to do is talk about the Lord. It's so exciting. Oh, hallelujah. I get beside myself again. All I knew was talk about the Lord, and lo and behold, they got thrown in the jail at the midnight hour. They got thrown in jail at the midnight hour when they were there. But they didn't get down in the dumps. They was in a predicament. I preached this the other week. They was in a predicament in a mind. But they said, you know what? We're going down. We're going down with a fight. Hallelujah. Not with a fish fight, but with a godly fight. Hallelujah. And they said, you know what? We're just going to sing and give praises to God. And they began to sing, give praises, and God began to shake the house. Hallelujah. And because they was there in that predicament, because God went whithersoever they went, hallelujah, the jailer and his family were saved because God was with Paul and Silas. Let me tell you, if you don't think God's with you, just keep holding on. Keep standing. Hallelujah. Because God will be with you no matter where you go, no matter what you face, no matter what you go through. God will be right there with you.
Glory to God.
Hallelujah. When Paul was on the ship, he was there and he was a prisoner. He told them, he said, don't leave. Don't leave this dock. Don't leave this docking station. Well, nobody would listen to a prisoner. But where they messed up, or where they made a mistake, was they didn't listen to a godly prisoner. And they set sail, and lo and behold, the ship had come battered and torn. Y'all know the story. They had to go overboard. Some got to land by swimming. Some got to land on boards. But they all got to land safely because Paul had a right relationship with God. And God had to let Paul know that there won't be any loss of life as long as everybody listens to what I'm telling them that God said. And so there wasn't a loss of life. But then they go on their whole, and it gets better. They go on the land. They go on the land, and what did the barbarians are there, right? Barbarians are there, and they got this fire out there, and lo and behold, a viper lays hold on his hand. Yeah. And they begin to think he's a god. They begin to think he's some powerful person. Paul. And they begin to think that. But you know what? Paul was just being obedient to God. And those barbarians were not mean and not hateful. And they didn't treat them bad. They treated them good. You know why? Because God was there with them whithersoever they went. Hallelujah. God was right there the whole time. It didn't matter what was going to take place or what was going to happen. God was there. Oh, hallelujah. You want to go back to the Old Testament? All right, Jonah. Jonah told God, no, I'm not doing that. And so he ran away. He paid money to get away from God. But God had prepared a great fish, and that great fish swallowed up Jonah. Jonah was in there, and seaweed and everything in around his neck, and everything. But God was there the whole time because he began to pray and see God. And that big fish, that great fish, spit up on dry land. And then he didn't back talk God no more. He went where God said. But oh, yes, he got discouraged. He got discouraged because God didn't destroy them. God, you sent me to a fish's belly. You want me to go preach to them about you're going to destroy them because of sin. And now you ain't destroyed them because they repented. Well, isn't that what it's about, church? It's about repentance. It's about people getting their hearts right with God and getting everything right. You see, God was there with us wherever. Oh, hallelujah. This has been good for me. I don't know. Hallelujah. God was there the whole time, no matter what they was going through. And you can hear story after story after story through the Bible. God was there with us wherever they went. One more account, and I'll move on. Jesus walked on the face of the earth for approximately 33 and a half years. Walked on the face of the earth. He preached the gospel to himself, healed by him, by his love, mercy. Tried to reach out to people, bless people, heal people, touch people, minister to people. They didn't like Jesus. They didn't like him. They wanted to crucify him. They put him on a cross on Calvary. Put him on a cross. Hung him between two thieves. Made him look like a spectacle. Made him look like a horrible person. The whole time he was without sin, had no sin, and had no guile found in his mouth. Jesus Christ was the perfect Son of the awesome God. But even in that, God was there. God the Father was there with him. because God was there whithersoever he went. Because when he was there on Calvary, and he was looking out across the sea of people, the land of people, everybody was out there crucified, crucified, crucified. As he was hanging there, he said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." God was there the whole time. Hallelujah. So you know what? We might feel like sometimes out here in this cruel, hateful world, we get crucified, or we get beat down, or we get mocked, or made fun of. Sometimes we might feel down and out, but let me tell you, God's with you. Hallelujah. God will lift you up. God will bring you forth through it. God will help you to get through that. He'll be right there with you. Hallelujah. God was right there. Hallelujah. God was right there. During the battles, during the fire, during the trials, God will always be there if you'll hold on. If you'll trust him. Thirdly, God made him a house. God made him a house. Who? King David made him a house. You see, God had sent word. David wanted to build. And God had sent word. And God said, you know what? I've lived in tents. And I've lived in tabernacles. I've lived in all these places. And then he ends up, and David's going to build a temple, and they're going to build a place for to be worshipped, a place, but it would be made with man's hands. They would build a temple, and you have to have a temple. They had to have a temple that was made that God could be worshipped in, and God could be praised in, and God could be glorified in. But you see, the temple, these physical temples, these physical houses are made with mortal hands. They're made by people. But you see, God's wanting a tabernacle, or God's wanting a house. It's not made with mortal hands, but a house is made by him. Hallelujah. A house that he makes. Oh, hallelujah. A house that he decides where it should be. Verse 11 said, "Also the Lord telleth thee that he will make thee an house." Not a physical house, but the house. He tells David, Nathan tells David, says, God says he's going to make you a house. Hallelujah. You see, it was God that built David's house. David's physical house, God allowed it to happen. Everything that was going on in David's time and David's house and David's household, it was God that was allowing that to happen. You see, it was God that did that. And it was God that built and accomplished David's house and caused that to be physical. It was God that created him as an individual. God that created man. As we learned in Genesis, as we learned this morning in Sunday school, God created man after his own likeness, his image. And so it was God that made who he was and made what he was supposed to be. You see, it was him that made, it was God that made his physical house, his bodily house. But it was God that made his whole kingdom. It was God that made his spiritual house. You see, God was making a house out of David, not a physical house that you might think of, like you might look at as a nice house or a building, but he was making him a house that God could reside in, that God could be present in, that God could be a part of that house. And that's what we need more in today's time, is people that are willing to say, God, make me a house. Make me a house. Hallelujah. Make me into what you want to make me. Hallelujah. Help me to be that house that you can be on the inside and you can do what you need to in my life. You can mold me and you can make me. You can be that potter. And out of the clay, God, let your will be done in my life. Let whatever it is take place in me. Let whatever you desire to take place in my life. Amen. Hallelujah. It was God that made his kingdom. It was God that made his name. His name was going to be well known. His name is well known in today's time. In 2020, David's name is well known. King David is well known throughout the world. King David, his name, hallelujah, his leadership was well known. We understand how he led Israel. How do we know that? Because we read scripture. But the people in those days, they didn't have all the scripture to read. But they saw it physically, firsthand, that God created David to be that house. That he could be that leader, that leadership that they needed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. His anointing. Hallelujah. His anointing that he had was God given, not man given, not man thought of, and not man called, but he was God called. Oh, hallelujah. That'll pray. There's so many people that are man called behind the pulpits across this world. Hallelujah. Instead of God called, God's looking for some God called people. Hallelujah. That'll call them to be his house. Hallelujah. And he created. Hallelujah. His house of worship. Hallelujah. You see, we're supposed to be that house, that vessel that we house God in. And God is a move and minister. And everywhere you walk, it should be God shining forth. Everywhere you talk, it should be God speaking forth to people. Everywhere you turn, everywhere you go, every move you make, it should be God. If we're allowing God to make us a house. Hallelujah. To make what we need, just like with David. If we're allowing God to do with us like David allowed God to do all of it with his physical house, bodily house, his kingdom name, leadership, anointing, and him being a house of worship. If we're allowing God to do that, then you know what? We'll accomplish something in this day and time. We'll accomplish something. Then, preacher, we're going to accomplish. We're going to accomplish souls being won. Souls being led. That's what we're going to accomplish. Hallelujah. It doesn't matter how eloquent you might speak or how non-eloquent we speak. Don't matter how politically correct we are or not politically correct. What matters is what's Jesus doing in us. How's he coming out to people? How's he shining to people? Are we a house that he can call home? Or are we not? Hallelujah. I don't want me, myself, my house to be like a hotel room that he rents. I want to be his house. Whatever God wants to do in me, I want him to do. Hallelujah. You know what? So I can shine forth for somebody else to see God in me. Not for me to get the glory. Nothing about me, nothing within me, nothing I have, nothing I've done is me. It's God.
Amen.
It's not an I. It's God. It's God that did. Hallelujah. Yes, he's blessed me. Yes, he's touched my life. He's blessed my family. He's blessed our home. But you know what? It's God. It's nothing I can do, nothing I can say, except God did it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If we'll just let God be God, we can be the house God's called us to be. If we'll just let God be God, God will make us the home for him that he desires if we'll let him. If we'll let him work in our life. If we'll let him move in our life, we'll let him do the work, do what he desires in us, we'll be that home, that house of worship, that temple that he wants to reside in. You see, our house of worship, he'll make his. This house of worship, and then when we individually are his house of worship, we'll be corporately his house of worship, and we'll be able to worship God. We'll be able to worship him because we come together as everybody being a house of worship individually and let God have his way. Hallelujah. That's what we need to pray. God, make me a vessel. Make me a vessel. Hallelujah. Our body is our home is a place of worship. Our body is a house of praise. Our physical. That's why we're supposed to let God do all the work. See, what happens is in life is we try to clean up. You know, when you take a shower, when I take my weekly shower, when I take a shower, you know, I wash my hair, and I clean my body, I wash with a wash rag, soap, all that. Do what I'm supposed to, right? I clean my outside. But there's nothing I can do to clean the inside of you. I can't, and I done told you, when I'm hurting, I'm hurting more than anybody. So you know I'm not going to take some kind of weapon and open myself up and clean the inside. I'm not doing that. I can't clean the inside. And what we have a problem with in the church world is we try to clean everybody's inside. Or try to inside and we try to clean everybody's outside before God does the work. You see, God's the only one who can clean the inside. You can harp on something all you want to. I can harp on something all I want to, but I can't clean the inside of man. I can try to help you, but God doesn't clean on the inside. When he does that, then all the outside gets clean. All the outside gets taken care of. All the outside gets good. When we become the house God's called me, God calls. Hallelujah. God calls us. Hallelujah. And he's always there with us wherever we go. And if we'll be the house that God wants to make us, it's going to require some things. And I just a few things wrote down. Some things that it's going to require. If we want to be the house, if we want God to make us a house, here's what it's going to require. First of all, it's going to require dedication. We're going to have to be dedicated to God. Not dedicated to man, not dedicated to this or that, but dedicated to God.
Amen.
We're dedicated to God, we can be the house he wants us to be. It's going to take desire. If you're comfortable right where you're at in God, then you're not going to get any closer. But if you desire to have all of God that he wants to give you and be the house he wants you to be, you've got to have desire. Because desire causes determination, causes dedication. Thirdly, you've got to have trust. You've got to trust and believe in God. It goes with faith. You've got to have trust in him. You got to believe he's going to do what he said he would do. Just because he hasn't done it today don't mean he's not going to do it. Amen? Just because whatever you've been praying for is not done right now doesn't mean he's not going to do it. Means he's going to do it in his time. Sometimes He has already done it, we just don't like the results. Because sometimes when we pray about things and ask God for things, sometimes He answers us by not doing anything about it. Because of things that we ask for, a situation we ask Him to work out, sometimes it wouldn't be for God's glory. And if it's not going to be for God's glory, it don't need to be done, right? Because we're supposed to live our lives pleasing and honor to Him. And so it's got to be His glory. It's got to be for Him. It's got to be all about God. Hallelujah. We're going to have to give Him our time. We're going to have to give Him our time. Time is very important. I'm different than a lot of people. When you say, I already know that. But anyways, I don't like to be rushed. I don't like to be rushed. You can ask or you can come by and time me. And I'm not bragging on me. Everybody does what they need to do. I'm not downing anybody. But I don't like to be rushed. So I always get to work early. I always get to church early. I try my best to get everywhere I go. If there's a time I'm supposed to get, I always get early. Because I'm the type, and I set my clock to get up early. If I oversleep, or if I get somewhere late, or if I'm not early, it does something to me. It does something to my body. And I don't know how to handle it. And so that's just me. I'm not talking about anybody. I'm not talking about anything. I'm just telling that that's me. And so time is very important to me. Well, I like to know when I'm supposed to be here, what I'm supposed to be doing. I like to know time. I like to know that time. And that time we've got to give. See, God's outside of our time. And all this time, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week that God gives us, and all that time and all those days and all those times of being early to here, early to there, late to here, late there, whatever the case, we need to make time, not find time, but make time for God. And I would dare say, even myself included, I would dare say we probably all need to make more time for God. I mean, I'm just being honest. Because I know I don't give God the time He deserves. I know I don't give Him as much time as He needs or would desire for my life. So I've got to work on that more and more and more. And I have lately. But I've got to give more to Him. I've got to give more time to Him, because I want to be that house that He can call His temple or His place of worship, His place that He can come reside and can spring forth and let the blessings and the miracles flow out to people, not just to me, to people, to others, so they can have time and then step it out in faith. You know how that song says, step into the water, way down a little bit deeper, wet your feet in the water of His love. Y'all know that song?
Yes.
Step into the water. You know what step into the water is? That's faith. Frederick, how's that faith? Well, I might be the only one in here, but there might not. How many in here cannot swim? I can't swim. I got one, two, three of us. Four of us can't swim. I don't know how to swim. I swim like a rock. Not like a fish, but like a rock. That's how I swim. So stepping into the water physically is an act of faith, because I'm trusting that next step and boom, here I go. Amen?
Amen.
When I get in a pool, I make sure I look around at the edges and make sure how deep it is. And if it's over my head, you know where I'm at most of the time. If I'm in a pool, I'm holding on to the edge. I might be in the deepest end, but I'm holding on to the edge. I'm not letting go. I'm holding on like something was just stolen. I got my fingers grabbed on, you know? It's faith. Step into it. And that's what God is going to require for us to be the vessel or the house He wants to be and build in us. We've got to step out in faith. And we're going to say, God, I don't feel You right now, but I know You're here. So I'm just going to step out and do what You're leading me to do. God, I don't know how to sing. I don't know how to do that. But if You're telling me to say that, that's what I'm going to say. If You're telling me to sing that, that's what I'm going to sing. God, if You're telling me to do that, that's what I'm going to do, because I got to step out in faith. And when we step out in faith just a little bit, it grows us up and we can step out a little farther. And before long, we're already all the way out in the deepest part of the ocean. And we out there and we say, God, I've stepped out. I'm talking about physically. Don't step out into the ocean and walk all the way to the middle. I'm just using it as a figure. Okay? Just as a figure of speech. But just when we step out and we get farther and farther, God gets us out there to where he can really mold us and make us. Because when you just get to the point, when you just get to, I'm just going to be just old country tonight. When you get to the point where you just don't care what people says, as long as you're pleasing God. When you get to the point that you don't care how goofy it looks, or how weird it looks, or how crazy it seems, you just step out in faith with God. When you do that, God is able to do the work that needs to be done in your life and every life around you. I'm talking about stepping out in faith. I'm talking about when God begins to move within you, and God begins to build you up into that vessel, into that temple that he can be in, that temple where you can honor him and glorify. That's why we have to make us an altar. That's why we have to pray. That's why we study the word to show ourselves approved, a word we need not be ashamed of the gospel. That's why we go to church, so we can be built up, so we can be that temple, that place of worship that God can reside in, that we can live for him and do what he has to do. That's why he wants us to do all those things, so he can grow us day in and day out, and we can go forth and do his will. God's calling you and I. We can be a house for God if we'll just let God. We can be a house for God if we'll just let God. Just let God have his way. Hallelujah. I've gotten to a place in my Christian walk, and I'm not bragging. I'm not bragging on me, but I'm telling you, God has just blessed in my Christian walk that I've gotten to a point that it doesn't matter to me what people say about me. As long as I'm obedient to him, that's all that matters to me. That's what matters. I want people to like me. Don't get me wrong. I'm not ignorant. I might seem like it, but I'm not. I'm not ignorant. I want people to like me. I want people to love me. But I love everybody. But you know what? I know, and I'm not naive enough to not think that some people just ain't going to like me. And that's fine. And people are going to talk about, well, that crazy preacher said this, or that crazy. It's okay. If God is in it, the world will not destroy you. If God is in it, and which he is, when I preach the word of God, I know what God places in here and in here. I know what God has placed in mine. And when I preach it, or teach it, or tell it, or say it, I know that God's placed the desire in here. Hallelujah. There are people around this world, the naysayers, the ones that's against God, don't like it or are against it. So be it. I'm just going to keep serving God. I'm going to keep letting God lead me and guide me. And that's the mindset we've got to get. No matter what somebody else might say or do, if we'll be the temple, be the house God can reside in, God will work everything out for you and I. God will work everything out. Hallelujah. All we got to do is trust him and believe. Trust and believe, and God will do the work. Hallelujah. Sister Beverly, would you come play? God, send me by tonight. This is an encouraging message. I know it's not as wound up as this morning was, praise the Lord. But God wants us to understand, just like for King David, just like for David, he wants us to be a house of worship. He sent Nathan back with the word, I'll make thee a house. I'll make thee a house. I'll make it for you. I'll make you, thee, a house. And that's what he did. He made David a house that was well known across the land that God used for his glory and his name. And that's what I want to be. I want to be one of those vessels that God can use. There's a song in the, I don't know if it's in the Redback hymn, but it's in one of the Blue hymn, I think. Jesus used me, don't refuse me. That's what I want to be. I want to be a person that Jesus uses. Hallelujah. I'm not perfect by no means, but I try my best to be obedient, and I want to be used for his service. I want to reach those ones that are down in the gutters. I want to reach those ones that are struggling. I want to reach those ones that have backslidden and went away. I want to reach those as best as I can for the glory of God. I want God to be God in my life. I want to be that house of worship that he wants me to be. Worship and honor. Tonight, this moment, we're going to stand and we'll pray. And I ask you, if there's anyone here, anyone watching, if you don't know the Lord's a personal Savior, all you got to do is repent, tell him you're sorry, and ask him to help you in your life and forgive you your sin. He'll come in and forgive you and cleanse your life, make you whole, and you can serve him. those that have been Christians forever, how long? God's calling us back to be those houses of worship. He wants to make us the people that He wants us to be. The hustle and bustle of life gets us busy every day. Everybody's busy. Everybody. That's just life. We're all busy. But there has to come a point in life where we say, you know what? God, have your way in me. Have your way in me. Use me, God. Have your way in me, that I'll be the vessel you've called me to be. And that's what He'll do. And so I came by to encourage you tonight. And as we pray in just a moment, this prayer we pray, I want you to praise and ask God to help you to be that vessel. Help you to be that temple that He can reside in, and He can bless you and help you go forth and win the lost at any cost. That's what it's about. The harvest is ripe, church. The harvest is ripe. It's ready. But the laborers are few. He's looking for some laborers, some people that will be those houses of worship for Him. House of people of worship. A house of honor that He has called us to be. If everyone will stand with me. You just pray as if you was called upon in the way that you know how. You just talk to God in your own way. These altars are always open. If you want to pray at the altar, come on and pray at the altar. But I know with this pandemic and all, we're trying to social distance, I understand. But if you want to pray at the altar, come on and pray at the altar. I'll pray with you if you want me to. I don't mind. Hallelujah. But as we pray this prayer, ask God to help you to be that house of honor that He's called you to be, that vessel He wants you to be. Heavenly Father, I come before you tonight loving you and praising you. I thank you one more time for this message. I thank you one more time for everybody here tonight, God. Everybody that's watching online, everybody that's viewing live stream, everybody that will watch this coming week, God, I thank you for them, Lord. They're part of this church. Everybody here is a part of this church. God, we thank you for them. We thank you for your love and your mercy. We thank you for being there with us. We thank you for being right there, leading us and guiding us and helping us. Lord, tonight I appreciate the message you've allowed us to have, the words that you've given us to encourage us, that just like King David, that you'll be right there with us. You called us for a purpose. You called us out of the deep miry clay for a purpose. You called us, and you'll be right there with us. Whithersoever we go, you'll be right there with us. And you called us to be that vessel. You called us to be that house. You'll make us a house of worship, a house that you live inside of, a house that you clean, a house that you make what it needs to be, a house that we can praise you and honor you, a house that we can reach the lost in the cause, a house that we can be a witness and a testimony, a house that you can reach down and use us for your glory and name. Say, God, I ask you to move within each and every one of us that we can go forth and do your will. Lord, watch over us. Lord, help us to be those vessels of honor, those vessels of praise, those vessels that you can call us, that you call us to be, those vessels that you can use us for to do your will. Lord, I ask you to reach down and bless every heart, every life, every soul tonight that's here, everyone that's watching. Bless them and keep them safe. Keep everybody safe as they go about their travels. Lord, all those that are sick and afflicted, bless them and touch them tonight, God, and be with each and every one. Go with us wherever we go. Go with us, God, and reach down and help us to be that vessel of honor. We love you tonight, and we praise you and thank you for all things. In Jesus' wonderful holy name we pray. And the church said,
amen.
Amen. Thank each and every one of you for coming tonight. Thank you for being with us. Don't forget, Jesus loves you. Pastor David loves you as well. God bless you, each and every one. God bless you.